Listening Library presents Crown of Thunder by Tochi Onyebuchi. Read for you by Prentice Onayemi. Chapter 1. The setting sun cuts ribbons of red and blue across the sky. Night's on its way, which means so are the Inisisa sent to kill us. The rebels say that after I peeled back the shadows of that boar, that sin beast I called forth from myself, I passed out. Makes sense that I don't remember it, but it makes it all harder to believe. Not remembering makes it easier to question things, to wonder if it's all really true. Maybe I never called forth my own sin, the sin that turned into a sin beast that glowed. Maybe the battle at the palace was a dream. Maybe I could say the same for the Arashi that flew out of the sky and set the city of Kos, my city, on fire. Maybe I dreamed up Princess Karima's betrayal too, and bows. It's easy to wish things were different. It's hard. It feels impossible even to go back and make things better. I'm right on a cliff's edge, and valley spreads about beneath me. There's more green down there than I've ever seen in my entire life, so different from the browns and reds, of course. Whenever I close my eyes, I see those streets, and I see the jewels of Gemtown sparkling in the sun, threatening to blind you if you look at them directly. I see Kosians wandering that part of the forum where jewelers sold their wares, everyone in bright colored robes and wraps, shouting to be heard over one another, arguing prices, examining gems, turning canes or necklaces or ear stones over in their hands. Then I open my eyes again, and all I see in front of me is strangeness. An explosion sounds in the distance. I don't even need to squint to know it's coming from Kos. It's not the continuous roaring of the Arashi, that enormous, mythical monster that had come out of the sky, drawn by the army of sin beasts Karima and her palace mages had summoned. It sounds more like a baptism, like a dahya getting demolished, a whole neighborhood quarter turned to rubble. My chest warms with anger. Things were supposed to be different. I can't believe that Karima's as callous as the previous rulers, of course. I still remember her touch. I can feel her fingers running along the sin spots on my arms and shoulders. Leaves rustle in the tree branches overhead, and I turn around just in time to see Nor leap down and land behind me as gracefully as any coarse street cat. White pupiled eyes shine out over the black cloth pulled up over her. I trained this young sin eater once, in a forest just like this. She joined us in the battle to save Kos, and she fled the city with us when all was lost.
Oga,
she says by way of greeting. I still can't tell if she's calling me boss as a joke or if she really means it. I'd be surprised if she still looks at me as a leader. What's the news, No? I sit down by the ledge. She steps next to me, fists balled at her sides. She's constantly coiled now. Whenever I see her, she's ready to knock out someone's jaw or gouge out someone's eyes.
It'll be time to eat soon.
All right. I grunt as I get back to my feet. I should count myself lucky I got even that tiny slice of time to myself. I almost want to ask Nor to stay with me a little bit and watch the sunset, but some of the rebel mages have been making noise about airborne Inisisa. Scouts, they say, in the form of birds and sometimes bats. And if I were to sneak out from under the cover of the forest and one of those things were to see me, Karima would know exactly where to send her army. If I were the only one I had to worry about, it wouldn't be a problem. But I know as soon as I step out and get spotted, every loose sin beast in Kos will be sent straight for me. Nor and Ras and the others would try to get in the way. The rebel mages would try to shield me, and by the end, there'd be a bunch of dead bodies everywhere just because I wanted to catch a sunset. Under those circumstances, it seems like not being late for supper is the least I can do. No need to make everyone's job harder than it already is. Even though we are all equals in the forest, the Aki and the mages still dine apart. Once upon a time, we walked for those same mages. For a few Ramzi, we Aki would go where the mages sent us. They would call forth some rich Kosian's sin, and once we killed and ate it, they would get a purse heavy with money. Then they'd hand us barely enough of the Ramzi inside to feed ourselves. A few of the sin eaters keep me company. They are my bodyguards. I'm not sure how to feel about it. When I was in charge of these kids, training them under the watchful eye of other palace mages, their skin was unblemished, no tattoos, no marks from battling in Isiza. Then I had to train them how to fight, how to eat sins. Now they sit or stand or lounge around me with bowls of egusi soup, and I see the mark of a sin bird's open wings on one of their arms. A sin lion rears up on its hind legs along another Aki's thigh. One Aki girl has a sin sparrow tattooed just beneath her left eye. They chat with one another, but they mostly do the silent, stoic thing that serious bodyguards are supposed to do. It's a thing Bo used to do. As soon as I think of Bo, my heart sinks. Sometimes when I sleep, I dream of our fight. I remember standing on the steps to the palace and Karima telling me to come rule course with her. I remember telling her no and seeing Bo come up the steps. I remember feeling glad to have him back. But even in the dream, I know something's wrong. And all of a sudden, Bo is on top of me with his dagger aimed at my heart, and it takes all of my strength to keep him from cutting it out of my chest. Some of the mages, currently eating on the other side of the campfire, were there to watch the whole thing. They saw Kos in its final moments. The one with the silver braids, Miri, is the one all the rebel mages listen to. But sometimes Miri and Aliya head off together into the darkness, and it's usually pretty soon after they get back that we have to get up and get moving again. The urge sometimes bubbles up in me to go to Aliya, but it always evaporates a second later. I don't know what I'd say to her or what exactly I'd ask her. Maybe something about the Inisiza I supposedly called from myself, or maybe something about the fact that I can't remember it. Maybe I would ask her if all those things she said to me on the steps to the palace were real. All those things about me staying true to myself and not being seduced by Karima and the power she offered me. Maybe I'd go to her just to be near her. She's different now. She's not the same girl I met at Zoe's all those months ago, so eager to learn about sin eating and equations that she would spill tea all over me. But there's still some of that curiosity there, some of that hopefulness. I see it at night when I catch her sneaking out to stargaze, her eyes bright and wide, just like they used to be all the time. She's chewing on some goat meat, and she's got her head cocked to the side while another mage whispers to her about something. She finishes, licks her fingers, then tosses the bones into the fire. Grease stains her robe, but she either doesn't see it or doesn't care. I don't notice that I've been staring directly into the fire until she nudges me. "Tash, are you okay?" she asks. I shake away the dizziness. "Yes, I'm fine." But I'm not. I'm thinking about those explosions again, imagining houses crumbling in a baptism, whole dahia demolished. I find myself replaying all those conversations Karima and I had about sin and about eating and about the unnamed. I remember how her eyes lit up when she saw me. She didn't sneer at my sin spots. She didn't wrinkle her nose the first time she saw me in the palace. When she looked at me, I felt loved. And now, under her command, dahia are crumbling. Was she lying to me the whole time? Aliyah's gaze softens.
You're thinking about Karima?
I shrug and hug my knees. What did I even mean to her?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.